motivated.
Get motivated.
Get motivated. Hip hop motivator. Blow of wisdom on the mic with Sean.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I hope you all are motivated, and I thank you for tuning in to a live edition of Flow of Wisdom Radio. Of course, I'm your host, Sean Anthony. My website is flowofwisdom.com, and please get connected with me on that website. Share the links, share the articles, share the posts that I post on flowofwisdom.com. You know, this is the third series, the third edition of the series that I've been covering over the past couple of weeks now on the Boule, Steve Coakley, and the Roundtable. And ladies and gentlemen, I must tell you, I mean, for those that have been following Flow of Wisdom for some time, you know that what's the saying called? I keep it real. I don't know how to be fake. I'm not a phony dude. I keep it thorough and honest. And I got to tell you, man, you know, since I've been doing this series and the more information I continue to uncover, in addition to the information that I knew prior to starting this series, it is just absolutely amazing. I am just amazed at the level of people that are involved in this fraternity, Sigma Pi Phi. And if you're just tuning in for the first time, as far as just checking out this series, you know, for the first time, I would urge you to go back and listen to the first two shows, last week's show and, of course, the first show. It's all on flowofwisdom.com. And I'm just simply laying the foundation and the track work just to continue on to connect the dots and show the links and peel back the layers of the onion. This network, this fraternity is so I'm just at a loss of words. Like I've been researching all the way up until this mic just got cut on. Like I'm still uncovering information and articles and reading different pieces of literature on this subject to further share with you guys. And it's just, I just shake my head and just disbelief. Not in the sense that I don't believe what I'm researching or anything like that, but it's just an amazement. We are talking about the most brilliant, wealthy black men in the United States. Like the sharpest, the best of the best. And their lineage, it continues, like it just does not stop. And if you look at some of the accomplishments, I won't even say some, if you look at the accomplishments of these prestigious men that are under the label, the title of Sigma Phi Pi, Pi Phi, the Boule, there you go. One would be proud. Like I said, I can't fake it or anything else. But when I look at the accomplishments of these black men, it is just, you really feel proud. Like, this is just amazing. We are talking about the sharpest minds in the country and have very, very, very much strong power and influence. Doctors, lawyers, surgeons, entrepreneurs, chief financial officers, accountants, judges, senators, congressmen. I mean, you name it. They've gone to the best educational institutions in the country. They have achieved some of the highest honors that some of the Ivy League schools and some of the prestigious historically black colleges, they've received the highest honors. But the question still remains, as the meaning that I've established already in the previous shows, the Boule means advisors to the king. Who is their king? Who are they serving? And it's already a documented fact. The founder, Henry Minton, thought that black, learned, and professional men should have an organization that should be a fraternity in the true sense of the word, one whose chief thought should not be to visit the sick and bury the dead, but to bind men of like qualities, tastes, and attainments into a close and sacred union that they might know the best of one another. And when you hear that phrase, at least for me, what exactly do they mean by wanting to know that they might know the best of one another? As I peruse over the past week, as I peruse through some of the photos that I see of these members celebrating new archons that are coming in, that have graduated and been initiated into the Boule, I look at these pictures, sharp, sharp men with their beautiful wives, standing with their hands in a particular way, which, you know, when you start researching other secret societies such as the Skull and Bones, which they're tied to, and other Freemasonry, you know, that hand gestures, the way that they hold their hands in pictures, and all of that stuff is strategic. It's not on purpose. And I'm studying some of these pictures as I'm looking at these new archons that were announced last spring of 2015. Two members on the out, like if it's a photograph of four men, the two on the outside may have their right hand covering their left hand, but the two men in the middle may have the left hand covering the right hand. Just things that are strategic. And other photos that I've seen where the new archons are sitting down and their sponsor, if you will, would be standing behind them. The gentleman that will be sitting down on the chairs would have their both hands on their knees. And I look at this because my eyes have been open, and I guess I'm trained, if you will, to notice particular things. I don't see that as coincidental, how their hands are placed. I'm sure it has something to do with their fraternity. But again, as I said, if you look at this on the outside, looking in, as a young black man, like this is inspiring. This is inspiring. These well-accomplished individuals that are making an impact in their particular area of expertise, if you will. But who is their allegiance to? Now, I've been finding all kind of articles and been sent some very interesting articles as well. And there's one in particular that I like to reference because I kind of feel the same way this particular article closes it out. And I'm going to get into some stuff. I'm going to share some information just so you know. I'm going to drop some more names, some people that you may be familiar with, some you may not be familiar with. But it's just interesting. In this one article that I'm going to get into later on in the show, but they summed up this article with a disclaimer. And I agree with this disclaimer to an extent. And it says, I would like the reader to understand that most of these men and women were recruited to this organization, the Boule, at a young and very vulnerable age. These members probably had the idea that the Boule would assist the African-American movement, only to find no light at the end of the tunnel. And the person that wrote this article goes on to say we should take notice that Moses was a murderer. Malcolm X was a burglar, pimp, and hustler, and still made God's Dean's List. But nonetheless, as I stated at the beginning of this series, and I'll reiterate it, this series is to just present the information as it is, and also post the share the information and the links and the ties. But I don't believe that every member of the Boule, and I could be wrong in this statement, I don't believe that every member in this organization has some sinister plot or some sinister agenda, okay? As well as most, you know, fraternities. But when you look at it, because I know Freemasons, I know some men that are in the Masons. I have family members that are Freemasons. I have some friends that are Freemasons. And they do good deeds. They do their good deeds in their communities and for their other brethren within their organization. But when you look at the nucleus, the top of the totem pole, if you will, the ones that, you know, are the head decision makers, those are the ones that we really got to dig deep on and find out what their agenda is, because those are the ones that are going to uphold what the sole purpose of these secret societies, these secret organizations are for. Stick around. We're on the Boule, guys. It's going to get much deeper right after these messages on Flow of Wisdom Radio. All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Flow of Wisdom Radio. I'm your host, Sean Anthony. We're live on the Genesis Communications Network. And my toll-free number is 1-877-300-7645, 877-300-7645. And to Justin, my producer in the studio, I'm just letting you know I'm logging on. I'm into the stack so we can take any phone calls that may want to participate, call in, chime in at any moment throughout the show. And also, guys, you know, let you know that this series is totally interactive. We've had some great callers that called in over the past 2 weeks, chiming in and adding to this discussion, this topic of the Boule, Steve Coakley, and the Roundtable. And so far, we've established quite a bit. We've established quite a bit. And as I said last week, we must mention Steve Coakley's name when it comes to this subject of the Boule, because if it had not been for him, my conversations with him and my interview with him before he passed away a few years ago, I wouldn't have been able to take the course or direction that I have because of the interview with Steve Coakley. And from my understanding, like I said last week, he has to be mentioned when we talk about the exposing of the Boule, because from my understanding, he was the one that exposed it all back in the late 80s, early 90s. And then publications started to come out and certain books were written. And I'll get to some book titles that were shared with me to read. But man, this is just there's so many layers to this. There's so many layers, but we've established a great deal. And you know, I mentioned the Freemasons and all of that, and it reminds me of a conversation, part of the interview that I had with Steve Coakley on the Masons, when I asked him about, you know, Freemasonry, you know, these, you know, many people join organizations, fraternities, sororities, et cetera, you know, talk about that. And just listen to Steve break this down. Listen.
The Masonic movement in America, which is from the 1700s, every time you set up a Masonic organization, you need a charter from an existing organization. So in France, England, and Germany, charters were given in Europe that eventually came to America and deputized them. In the late 1700s, a black man named Prince Hall received a charter from some Army Irish military men, one including his father, who was white, and they set up the Prince, actually they set up what was called then the African Lodge, which was founded in Boston. I've been to his grave. That Prince Hall Lodge became the primary organization for the socialization of Negroes in America and was very influential up until the time that the Boule other higher societies came in existence. One good book is called The Aristocrats of Color by a professor from University of Arkansas named Good Gatewood.
The Aristocrats of Color?
Yes, and it talks about the church and that many of these earlier institutions, that, including the Boule, that were responsible for the integration of the Negro into high society. Later on, the black Masons wanted to imitate the white Masons, which is a scary thing, because the white Masons are imitating the original Kemetic or Akibalana African people. They're emulating them with the pyramids and the symbols. They then perpetrate this falsehood, and then really stupid black people come behind them and emulate the whites, who are actually emulating their grandfathers and grandmothers.
Let's take okay, go ahead.
The last part to this is that blacks began to imitate white society, so you ended up with a black Scottish Rite. You ended up with a black society for every name that a white had, and the whites wouldn't recognize the blacks. If you go to the Masonic Temple on 16th Street in Washington, D.C., the House of the Mother Supreme, where Albert Pike is buried in the walls, you can follow racism in these societies. The George Washington Masonic Memorial, which is on 15th Street in Alexandria, Virginia, you can follow the existence of those early American founding thieves and masonry.
All right, I'm going to pause it right there, and we're going to listen to the rest of this clip of Steve Coakley. We'll be back in a minute. Flow of Wisdom Radio. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. We are live. Flow of Wisdom Radio. Yours truly, Sean Anthony. Thank you to my affiliates, KSZL, 1230 AM in Barstow, California. KTYT, 99.3 FM in Chattanooga, Tennessee. And KBDB, 96.7 FM in Forks, Washington. And also shouts out to 101 The Fam in Richmond, VA. Carrie and Flow of Wisdom Live, I appreciate the love and the support for all the affiliates, and we hope and pray that we can grow more affiliates. And, you know, I understand that my show, as I've said before, it's a niche show. It's a very unique show when it comes to this genre of radio, and with my background being in hip-hop and in entertainment business for so long, I understand that I am a trailblazer. I am creating a new path in talk radio with this particular, you know, because, look, I understand there's other shows that cover certain subjects similar that I cover, but not many cover it to the extent that I do. And I'm cool with that. You know, I understand. And I just posted something on my social media the other day, too, that, you know, I'm getting a big response from this series and on social media. And I definitely appreciate it. But one thing I do understand is that the growth and support for Flow of Wisdom Radio has been organic, and it has been steady. Organic, and it just continues to grow. It hasn't been like boom, full blown, you know, worldwide, you know, all of that. But it's been organic, and I'm. My reach is growing. You know, it's amazing when I travel internationally, people, and I go overseas, people are like, yeah, we listen. They're listening, you know, and I get emails from people from the UK, from South Africa, people. I mean, it's just amazing. So I really appreciate the affiliates that are carrying it here in the States, And we just hope that we will continue to go. Now, let me get back to this clip, this excerpt that I was sharing with you from Steve Coakley. I'll take it back just a few seconds just so you can kind of pick up where he was leaving off, because it was almost done. But then after that, I want to get into some serious stuff here. But this was Steve Coakley finishing up his response about Freemasons and his thoughts on that. So listen.
Virginia, you can follow the existence of those early American founding thieves and masonry. And so they didn't want the blacks, but as the blacks got bigger and the whites got smaller, they then ended up merging the societies such that now they are all together. But the Masonic lodges are commoner organizations. Skull and Bones and Boule are higher organizations. All of them oath takers.
Oath takers. That's the late, great Steve Coakley. And man, what an individual. You know, the bravery and the courage that Steve Coakley did for many, many years, many decades, several decades at least, just digging and digging and digging and digging and putting all of the information together and just presenting it to the people. And, you know, he did this all across the country, you know. And as I was, you know, preparing for this week's show, I was I stumbled it was a bit by Chris Rock, the comedian Chris Rock. And this is something I was telling my oldest son last night about comedians, because little that people know that early in my radio career, I was a producer for a morning show, and on the morning show, it was the main host, and the co-host was a comedian, and this comedian owned the Comedy Stop. He owned a comedy restaurant and a Comedy Stop, and all the big name black comedians that are big today, they came through. This was back in the 90s. All the big comedians came through, like Cedric the Entertainer, Bernie Mac, Cheryl Underwood, you know, Cedric the Entertainer, all are D.L. Hughley. A lot of the guys that are prominent now, they were all making their rounds back then. So I had a chance to really study comedy, timing and wit and all of that other stuff. But one of the things I shared with my son is that some of the best comedians, they implement truth. They implement fact in their routine and layer it with humor. And the best ones do it very, very cunning, very wittily. You know, they're very brilliant at it. George Carlin is one. Dave Chappelle has his unique way of doing it. Chris Rock is one. And one of the things that Chris Rock was talking about, obviously I can't repeat the joke because it had a lot of filth in it, but nonetheless, he made a statement about blacks been in the Olympics since the 1920s. Think about that. He said blacks have been in the Olympics since the 1920s. And the reason why this stood out to me is because I'm on this series of the Boule, and we're talking about the establishment of this organization established in 1904. And he says, you know, this is before Rosa Parks. This is before this, that, and the third, you know, and it's like all of these different movements that happened in the 50s and the 60s. But yet you had just this prestigious elite of black men that formed this organization, an extension of the Skull and Bones. It's just utterly amazing to me. And it made me think about all the great accomplishments that's in our history. And I say our history as an American. All of this brilliance in our history that was left out of the public educational system. All of these great accomplishments were left out in our educational system. What was going on with the history during the early 1900s? You look at just these members of the Boule, they were like the first of the first surgeons, first, you know, doctors, first judges. I mean, all of these prominent positions. But yet our history teaches us in the public educational system, it doesn't teach us about these men. They just talk about the slavery. Only a few that we may hear about. You know, George Washington Carver, Frederick Douglass. But what was it that was going on? There's this void in our history that we weren't taught. We weren't taught about Black Wall Street in Tulsa, Oklahoma. I'll never forget when I first shared about the history of Black Wall Street on Floor. This was the early stages of Floor of Wisdom. I mean, people were calling in crying. I'll never forget, this lady called in tears, like, I never knew about this. But we got to put in the mindset of these individuals that, you know, that laid the foundation of this Boule. I mean, there was an interesting article I found that was published back in 2011 on the Bayview, which is a national Black newspaper in San Francisco. And it goes into the depth of Black Wall Street. And it says the name fittingly given to one of the most affluent all-Black communities in America was bombed from the air and burned to the ground by mobs of envious whites. In a period spanning fewer than 12 hours, a once thriving Black business district in northern Tulsa lay smoldering, a model community destroyed and a major African-American economic movement resoundingly diffused. The night's carnage left some 3,000 African Americans dead and over 600 successful businesses lost. Among these were, listen at this, ladies and gentlemen, 21 restaurants, 21 churches, 30 grocery stores, 2 movie theaters, a hospital, a bank, a post office, libraries, schools, law offices, half a dozen private airplanes, and even a bus system. And the article goes on. It says the best description of Black Wall Street, or Little Africa as it was also known, would be compared to a mini Beverly Hills. It was the golden door of the Black community during the early 1900s. And it proved that African Americans could create a successful infrastructure. That's what Black Wall Street was all about. The dollar circulated 36 to 100 times, sometimes taking a year for currency to leave the community. Now a dollar leaves the Black community in 15 minutes. What do young people do as soon as they get them some money? They go to what, Foot Locker or somewhere, and get the new Jordans. Which Michael Jordan ain't doing a damn thing for the Black community. The article goes on, as for resources, there were PhDs residing in Little Africa, Black attorneys and doctors. One doctor was Dr. Barry, who owned the bus system. His average income was $500 a day. That's hefty pocket change in 1910. It was a time when the entire state of Oklahoma had only 2 airports, yet 6 Blacks owned their own planes. It was a very fascinating community. The mainstay of the community was to educate every child. Nepotism was the one word they believed in. And that's what we need to get back to, the article points out. The main thoroughfare was Greenwood Avenue. And it was intersected by Archer and Pine Streets. From R&B music group, the Gap Band got its name. They're from Tulsa, Oklahoma. Black Wall Street was a prime example of the typical Black community in America that did business. But it was an unusual location. You see, at the time, Oklahoma was set aside to be a Black and Indian state. There were over 28 Black townships there. One third of the people who traveled in terrifying trail of tears alongside the Indians between 1830 and 1842 were Black people. The citizens of this proposed Indian and black state chose a black governor, a treasurer from Kansas named McDade, but the Ku Klux Klan said that if he assumed the office, that they would kill him within minutes. We'll be right back with more. All of this ties in together. We'll be back with Flow of Wisdom Radio. Thank you so much for tuning in. Flow of Wisdom Radio live here. I am your host, Sean Anthony, sharing an article written in San Francisco Bay View. This was published back in 2011 on Black Wall Street, and I'll continue with this article here. And I want to lead up to some questions, too, you know, to put out there. You know, but you look at this history that I'm sharing about Black Wall Street, and you look at these very prestigious men that started this organization called the Boule, that's linked to the Skull and Bones. Why would they do that? Why would they link themselves to the Skull and Bones? And these are rhetorical questions. I noticed I played an excerpt of Steve Coakley giving an explanation why, but you know, it still poses that question. Why would they want to affiliate with such an organization such as that? So that they may know the best of one another. Anyway, the San Francisco Bay View continues on with the Black Wall Street. A lot of blacks own farmland, and many of them had gone into the oil business. The community was so tight and wealthy because they traded dollars hand to hand and because they were dependent upon one another as a result of the Jim Crow laws. It was not unusual that if a resident's home accidentally burned down, it could be rebuilt within a few weeks by neighbors. This was the type of scenario that was going on day to day on Black Wall Street. When blacks intermarried into the Indian culture, some of them received their promised 40 acres and a mule. And with that came whatever oil was later found on the properties. On Black Wall Street, a lot of global businesses were conducted. The community flourished from the early 1900s until June 1st, 1921. That's when the largest massacre of non-military Americans in the history of this country took place. And it was led by the Ku Klux Klan. Imagine walking out of your front door and seeing 1,500 homes being burned. It's hard to fathom. Survivors we interviewed think that the whole thing was planned because during the time that all of this was going on, white families with their children stood around the borders of their community and watched the massacre, the looting and everything, much in the same manner they would watch a lynching. The riots weren't caused by anything black or white. They were caused by jealousy. A lot of white folks had had come back from World War I, and they were poor. When they looked over into the black communities and realized that black men who fought in the war had come home heroes that helped trigger the destruction. It cost the black community everything and not a single dime of restitution. No insurance claims have been awarded the victims to this day. Nonetheless, they rebuilt. We estimate 1,500 to 3,000 people were killed. And we know that a lot of them were buried in mass graves all around the city. Some were thrown into the river. As a matter of fact, 21st Street and Yale Avenue, where there now stands a Sears parking lot, that corner used to be a coal mine. They knew a lot of they threw a lot of bodies into the shafts. Now, to take a quick rabbit trail, that kind of reminds me of here in Richmond, Virginia, where I broadcast live. Down, you guys are following the March Madness and the NCAA tournaments and VCU basketball, VCU University. There's been a lot of protests. There's some buildings, some parking lots that's downtown Richmond where many blacks have been buried. No graves or anything, just tossed. And let's build buildings on top of it. It's all there. But anyway, I'll digress a little bit on this article on the Black Wall Street. What I'll do is I'll post a link after my show on theflowofwisdom.com so that you guys can read it in its full, because it talks about what initiated it. You know, they were trying to say that a black man looked at a white woman or tried to say that he raped a white woman or something like that, which was all lies. It came out that it was all lies. But that was the foundation, what I guess that initiate the bombing of an entire black community. But stick around, because hour two, we're going to continue. I have some names that I'm going to drop, some links to some people, prominent people that you may know and may have heard of that are in the Boule. And we'll talk more about that in hour two. Y'all stick around. It's Flow of Wisdom Radio. Get motivated. Get motivated.